Anyway, hello again. Here we are again. I seem to spend all my life trying out different microphones and plugs, trying to make this sound better. But hopefully you can hear me. Anyway, a little bit of admin to do first. I've got to do the results of the weekly competition. So I've got Mark Hollington, the manager, has sent me all the details. Okay, so first of all, the competition was to review, basically to review my book on Amazon or Goodreads, the only places it's probably going to get reviewed, to be honest with you, and then let Gary Sausages know. I'll give you details in a minute, and every week for who knows how many weeks, Mark will pick a review out of a hat, not this one, and the prize will be, and then you email him. I'm not explaining this very well, I'm going to read it here. Okay, the prize is any item from the Carter store. Okay, it's a weekly competition. Anyone who leaves a review on Goodreads or Amazon gets entered into a weekly prize draw for 4 or so weeks. That's optimistic. They just need to email garysausages@gmail.com to say they've done it. And every Friday, Mark will pull a random name from a hat, not this one. And that week's winner can pick an item from the Carter store. If your name isn't picked out, it doesn't matter, because at the end of it all, there'll be a big prize from all the weeks combined. Anyway, so, and if you haven't got email, you can notify them on the... respond to the Facebook post. I don't understand this. Anyway, okay. So this week's winner of is, lucky winner, drum roll, is Sarah or Sarah C. Sarah C. Not Carter, not a relative. Okay. So anyway, I'm going to do a little bit of reading, probably about 8 minutes or something like that, and then you can all return to your self-isolation and your social distancing. Anyway, okay. And yeah. Okay, I'm going to read chapter 9. I'm not reading everything, obviously, from the whole book, because then nobody would buy it. It's chapter 9. So basically, Nathan's sister, Zoe, is missing. That's pretty much all you need to know. And the police are searching for her. Nathan couldn't imagine how the police could have searched any harder for Zoe than they did. The helicopter arrived and shone a bright stream of light down on the park and the estate, reaching further than any torch ever could. PC Torres and PC Carey came back to the house in the morning, and other police came too. They searched the house again, taking a diary from Zoe's room, even though it had nothing written in it. The police walked through the estate, knocking on doors and stopping people passing by, speaking to dog walkers and postmen, and showing them the picture of Zoe. The police lifted the lids of wheelie bins, and they parted bushes. They forced open the jam door of a fly-tip cooker in the adventure playground and found nothing. The police looked under every car in the estate's underground car park, sticking their faces up against the window in case Zoe was asleep or hiding on the back seat. They walked around the whole park, crossing it from top to bottom and side to side, staring at the still water of the ponds and disturbing the flower beds inside the walled garden. The police checked the community greenhouse and walked through the sand and water play area. They searched the cafe and the stable block and spoke to the builders doing the renovation work there. The police looked for Zoe in the 1 o'clock club and all of the public toilets. They walked across the bowling green and tennis courts and searched the cricket nets. Nathan couldn't imagine how they could have searched any harder. And there were just so many places to hide or to be hidden, so many places to stay and such a lot of ways to leave. There were hundreds of buses and night buses, the tube and the underground, black taxis and Ubers, unlicensed minicabs and Boris bikes for hire. Everything that Nathan's dad said helped to make the area such a desirable place to live, and why the developers and the council were so keen for them to move out, so they could knock the estate down and build posh flats. Nathan's dad called it gentrification. Nathan asked his dad if he could help the police search. He wanted to go back to the park to look for the arrows and the post-it notes in daylight. His dad said there was absolutely no way he was leaving the house on his own. "I'm not losing another one," he said. In just a few days, the police had been at the house often enough for Nathan to learn some of their language. Zoe was a MISPA, a 15-year-old IC1 female missing person. The helicopter that flew above the estate and annoyed the neighbours was called India 99, and the Alsatian dog that barked at Nathan was a Delta. The two women who'd been at the house the most were called Flo's, which stood for family liaison officers. They dressed in normal clothes, usually black trousers and jumpers, and had their names on badges hanging around their necks like the boys who worked in JD Sports. The Flo's would be at the house so often that Nathan would almost forget they were the police. They already knew where the cups and the coffee were kept, and that the hot and cold taps in the kitchen were fitted the wrong way around. To Nathan, the two women looked and sounded so alike one another, he struggled to remember which Flo was called Janet and who was Anne Marie. Nathan's dad friend Craig said that was why they always sat in the same places on the sofa, to make it easier to identify who was who, like Ant and Dec. Nathan didn't think there was a good Flo and a bad Flo, they were just Flo's. Nathan learned the rest of the police alphabet, filling in the spaces between Alpha and Zulu. He was November Alpha Tango Hotel Alpha November, and Zoe was Zulu Oscar Echo. Their dad was Delta Alpha Delta or Sierra Tango Echo Papa Hotel Echo November to everyone who wasn't Nathan or Zoe. When Zoe had officially been missing for 3 days, the police filmed a television appeal. On the fourth day, it was shown on the local news. There were so many family members and friends and random people from the estate in the living room to watch it on television. It felt more like Nathan's dad was about to be a contestant on Britain's Got Talent. Craig brought a box of beer, and one of Auntie Maureen's workmates from Greg's bought cakes. Nathan sat on the living room carpet next to Craig because there was nowhere left to sit. Nathan's gran on his dad's side of the family was knitting on the sofa behind him. He was worried he was going to end up with an ugly yellow jumper because of Zoe. He pictured his sister really laughing about that when she came back. And Nathan still believed she would be coming back. With all the police in the living room and Maureen and her friends in their Greg's uniforms, and even the vicar dropping by briefly, Craig said they were two cowboys and a pirate, short of being at a fancy dress party. The one person most obviously missing, apart from Zoe, of course, and Nathan thought how brilliant it would be if she walked through the door when everybody was watching her appeal on television, was Nathan's dad. He'd gone upstairs to the toilet a long time ago and hadn't come back. The appeal began, and Maureen told everyone to be quiet. Nathan had never seen anyone he knew on television before. He never thought his dad would be the first. He was sitting behind what looked like a table for spreading paste onto wallpaper. There were two policemen sitting at the table with his dad. Nathan hadn't seen them before. There was a large picture of a police badge and a website address on the wall behind them, and two microphones on the table in front. The enlarged picture of Zoe was on an easel next to the table. Craig whispered to Nathan that it looked like they were auctioning a painting. When the policeman sitting to the left of his dad said her younger brother was the last person to see Zoe alive, Nathan thought it sounded like the policeman was investigating a murder instead of looking for a missing person. "You know, they film these things to look for crocodile tears," Craig whispered. "What are crocodile tears?" Nathan said. "Pretend tears. The police want to see if your dad's just pretending to cry." "Why would he pretend to cry if he wasn't really sad about Zoe?" "But he is. Of course he is, but they have to find this out. This is the quickest way." Nathan looked at his dad on television. "But he isn't even crying, though." "Well, I guess they're looking for that as well," Craig said. "Maybe they'd get more phone calls if he'd cried. People expect tears." The appeal was really short, and Nathan was glad when it ended. Everyone in the room started discussing it. The clickety-clack of knitting needles started again. Craig finished his beer and shook the empty can, a signal for Nathan to get him a fresh one. Nathan took the beer can and went out to the kitchen. He dropped it in the bin and opened the fridge. His dad hadn't been shopping since Zoe had disappeared, and the fridge was almost empty. Nathan had heard his dad telling the Flo's how guilty he'd feel choosing between brands of baked beans or standing in a checkout queue while his daughter was still missing. Nathan moved the slice of quiche Zoe had bought herself from Brixton Village to the back of the fridge and took out that last can of beer. He closed the fridge door and went back to the living room. Craig had moved to a space on the sofa. He was looking at his phone, and Nathan walked past and went upstairs to look for his dad. He found him in Zoe's bedroom, standing in front of her open wardrobe, staring at the space left by a red Converse. Nathan had seen his dad look at the gap on the bathroom shelf where Zoe's toothbrush should have been, in the same sad way. All the fairy lights in Zoe's bedroom had been switched on, the white ones draped around the headboard of a bed and chair, and the red, blue, yellow and green fairy lights inside long tubes that haloed the dressing table and framed the window. "Do you remember what Zoe used to say about fairy lights?" his dad said, when Nathan appeared in the doorway. Nathan shook his head. They're like dogs, because they're not just for Christmas. He gestured at the can of beer Nathan was holding. Is that for me? It's for Craig. How many left? Just this one. His dad nodded. He'll go soon then. I had a look on telly. Craig thought you looked like a football manager who's just lost the cup final, Nathan said. And Nathan's dad, Quarter, smiled. He looked across the room at the window. The curtains were half open. It was raining. Does Zoe have an umbrella, Nathan? He said. I don't think she even owns a proper winter coat. That's that. Thank you. Thanks for listening. If I do any more of these, I'll probably read from something else. Maybe I might read from the other story. Harvey King unboxes his family. I couldn't remember what it was called there. And then, however long this goes on, then I'll start reading. I'll read the Smash Hits Awards bit from the Goodnight Jim Bob book, and then I'll work my way through the Harry Potters. Thank you. Take care.